second guest of honor. Great pleasure to have here Mr. Tawseef Farooqi, who chairs one of the key government agencies in Pakistan's power sector, NEPRA, the National Electric Power Regulatory Authority. Mr. Farooqi, you have a more than 20 years background in the power sector, on the private sector side as well. You have also international background. You worked abroad, outside of Pakistan as well as inside Pakistan. So you know very well the sector, and you have now this key position, and we look forward to your keynote speech now in our webinar. Mr. Farooqi.
Thank you very much, Stephen. First of all, Stephen and Peter and all the organizers, thank you very much for inviting me. Okay. So I would like to talk about wind power development in Pakistan. Let me first walk you through what NEPRA is. Basically, we are the regulator, and we are a link between different important organizations in Pakistan in the power industry, first being the Ministry of Energy, who is the responsible for creating a policy in power sector. Then we have the system operator and planner, NTDC. Then we have got CPPAG, who is market operator as well as responsible for the settlement. Then we have two organizations called PPIB and AADB. PPIB is responsible for capacity addition for the conventional power, whereas AADB is responsible for the renewable energy addition in the country. And we have old WAPDA, which is primarily taking care of the hydro projects now. And we also have the nuclear projects, plus we have taken many other initiatives whereby you might know that Pakistan is very advanced in as far as IPP industry is concerned. We had our first IPP back in 1994, and we have close to 100 IPPs operating in Pakistan. Our NEPRA's role is very simple and as well as very complicated. We are supposed to keep a balance between the investment coming in the country, and we are also the custodian of the consumer's interest. And the typical electricity trilemma, we are responsible for that, thereby meaning that we have to ensure the affordable, reliable, and sustainable electricity coming to Pakistan. Why NEPRA's role is so critical? Because you know, if we would like to uplift the country, we have to fix the economy. And in order to kickstart the economy, we have to fix the industry, or we have to give a lot of incentive to the industry. And one of the key inputs for the industry is energy costs. So when I took over as chairman NEPRA last year, because before that I was in Abu Dhabi for 20 years, my biggest challenge is to bring down the electricity prices in Pakistan. And I feel there are only two ways of doing that. One is to fix the existing infrastructure in Pakistan. And the second thing is to induct the cheapest electron possible in the system, which we all know there's no brainer that RE projects everywhere all over the world are considered to be the cheapest projects, even though we have to take care of the intermittency and the other ancillary issues with that. But still, considering all that, it is still the cheapest solution available. So we have set ourselves some target. Basically, it's the GOP, or the government of Pakistan, as Peter said, that President of Pakistan announced it last year. We wish to take Pakistan's current 3% renewable to almost 22%, which is going to be wind 12% and solar 9% and bagasse almost 1% over next 10 years. So it's a substantial increase from 3% to 22%. And one more initiative that I have taken recently as chairman NEPRA is that I've written to the government to consider hydro as also part of the RE projects. That is going to give us an immediate boost in our RE, because if we go with the current plan, we'll be able to increase RE from 3% to 22%. But if somehow we'll be able to club hydro in that, then by 2030, we'll jack up our RE presence from 22% to 52%. And one substantial thing that you will notice that right now we are using 60% of thermal, which substantially we are going to reduce over a period of next 10 years, right from 60% down to almost 36%. So again, almost bringing it down to half. So this is what our target is and how we are going to achieve. Prime Minister of Pakistan has already announced his targets of taking RE to 20% by 2025 and 30% by 2030. That's what the minimum goal is. And we are targeting the commercial power generation and microgrids, as well as mature technologies like wind and solar and bagasse. We are also planning to experiment with the other technologies which are not tested in Pakistan, like geothermal, wind to energy, waste to energy, and wave, tidal, ocean, hydro, storage, etc. So all these things we are planning to try to sort of beef up our supplies on the RE side. This has been Pakistan's evolution on the regulatory regime for the last 23 years. NEPRA was formulated in 1997. And then first thing we did in the year 2000 was to bring out our tariff and licenses regime. Then we introduced fees, fines, and dispute resolution mechanism by 2033. In another 3 years' time, we brought distribution transmission codes. Then we worked on tariffs and started giving licenses. And we also experimented with the competitive bidding, which didn't turn out to be a very successful model at that time. And I would seriously question the challenge the implementation side of it, because in Abu Dhabi, I experienced competitive bidding to be the most successful way of adding capacity. Anyhow, we further kept on improving on competitive bidding. And now in 2020 policy that First Secretary just mentioned, we have decided that future RE projects will be based on competitive trading only. And we at NEPRA right now are finalizing the main RFP, because you will appreciate that few projects, they are called category 3 projects, which are 103, 103 projects. Government has decided to bring them under competitive bidding regime. So we are developing an RFP for that. And in first go, which we are expecting from between first to second quarter next year, we are going to have this competitive bidding thing initiated. And by before the end of next year, we are expecting to have a competitive bidding done by all those projects. And we are also working on competitive trade bilateral contracts market. So we are trying to change or bring about a paradigm shift in the way Pakistan has been operating as far as power industry is concerned. And from single buyer model, now we are coming up with a multi-buyer market. And NEPRA has very recently, about 2 weeks back, given a monumental decision whereby we have approved this model. And now we have given 18 months from the approval time for the implementation of this program. And you will also appreciate that NEPRA is now working on IGCEP, which is Integrated Generation Capacity Expansion Plan. First time in the history of Pakistan, we are trying to enhance or let's say do a capacity building in a scientific manner, whereby through IGCEP, we are going to keep our demand and supply sort of balance. And this plan is until 2047. 2047 is a monumental, is a very important milestone for us, because Pakistan will achieve 100 years of its existence in 2047. So they have actually brought, NTDC has brought this next 27 years model for us, which is a combination of all various technologies, including RE, hydro, gas, local coal, and LNG based project. But our focus is generally on RE. So these are the four evolution processes that we have gone through in NEPRA. First, we came up with the incentive-based policy to create traction for the investors. Then we did a hand-holding for the reasonable-sized wind and solar projects. And then we tried to remove whatever barriers were there to project for the project implementation. And then we put greater emphasis on competition based sustainable distributed RE market, which we are in the process of implementing now. In a way, we are super excited, because you would have probably all seen our flag, which is green and white. And I think generally in business terms, there's a terminology called early entrant advantage. We are very lucky that we are entering very late in this business because we have brought down, the industry has sort of crashed and the prices are way, way, way comparative now. So in a way, there is a late entry advantage for Pakistan into the RE regime. So this is the tariff regime that we have been giving. And you will probably notice that from cost plus, we continued and we improved it on to cost plus plus upfront. And then we went on to upfront because at that point in time in 2013, we had acute shortage of power in Pakistan, which is much, much relaxed now because now we have more comparatively more electricity than what we need. We have a nameplate capacity of 36,000 megawatts. And last year we used only around 24,000 megawatts. So we have some cushion available and we are now trying to sort of bolster this supply by giving incentive package to our consumers. Very recently, government has given a industrial package whereby to the large consumer, industrial consumer, we have given a 25% discount. And for the SMEs, we have given a 50% discount over the units they are going to consume over and above last year's consumption. This is just to make sure that from single shift, they go on to enhance their production by going into the second shift or even third shift. Another important milestone we achieved, we offered a straight package to them, a straight tariff, because earlier it was time of use tariff that was given to them. So it was a peak and off-peak rate, but we have abolished the peak rate for the industry. And instead of taking an average, we are now giving them for 24 hours on off-peak rate. It's a huge incentive for them. So you will see that right from 2011, when we had the first wind project, where the tariff was 14.66 cents per kilowatt hour, we have lately given the latest tariff at 3.2 cents per kilowatt hour. So we are having a very accomplished journey as far as tariff reduction is concerned. And we are super excited, as I said, because the time is ripe that we jack up renewable energy projects by inducting more and more wind and solar projects at a very, very affordable price of around 3 cents per kilowatt hour. At the moment, as we speak, we have almost 1,233 megawatts of installed capacity on wind projects. There are 224 wind projects which are operating in Pakistan right now. And as I said, if we are going to add 20,000 more megawatts in next 10 years, we are expecting half of it will be almost half, if not more, will be wind energy. So 12 projects are right now, as we speak, are under construction, which is equal to almost 610 megawatts. In a size of almost 36,000 megawatt installed capacity, again, these are not huge numbers, but as Chinese say, even 1,000 miles journey from a single step. So I think we have taken some very good steps. What are the challenges we are facing and what are the solutions? I won't actually call it impediments, but these are more like practical problems that we are facing and that we have to overcome to be able to sort of go ahead with adding more RE projects. The first one is that right now we have surplus power. As I said, our nameplate capacity is 36,000 against our demand of 24,000 megawatts. But as you all know that Pakistan is growing and Pakistan has a few things which are very, very promising, like our demographics. More than 70% of our population is under 29 years of age, and almost 35% of our population is less than 15 years of age. So in Pakistan, we have a very, very young population, and that is going to grow. And our fertility rate is second to none in the world. And so we are expecting more and more population in the days to come. Plus right now, which is not a very positive number to throw, but eventually this number shows that skies are the limits for us, because in Pacistan right now, our per capita consumption of electricity is only 450 kilowatt hours per person. But in compared to our neighboring countries, it is close to 1 megawatt. And if I compare it with the European average, which is around 5,005 kilowatt hours or 5.5 megawatt hours per year, per capita consumption, you know. So comparing to the Europe, we have, you know, a long way to go, but it's a huge potential for us. So how can we take care of that? We are now retiring all the obsolescent plants which are owned by the government. Very recently, we have taken a decision of retire 4,000 megawatts of old technology-based, very expensive, low-efficiency plants. So we are retiring 2,000 megawatts very soon, within this year probably, and next 2,000 will be done within next 1.5 years. Then we have some grid system constraints to evacuate power. Nationally, we have to identify a new interconnection ready zones and encourage distributed plants to be able to cater to that. Then we have limited capacity to manage variable RE. We naturally need to upgrade our capacity. We have to digitalize our the way we are managing stuff. We need to include or add SCADA system and make it more modern, you know, data acquisition system and monitoring system, basically. And then we have to centralize our RE forecasting. Right now, previously, it was more of a decentralized one, but we have to bring it in the centralized forecasting system. And we have to also capitalize on the battery storage. Naturally, we are very anxiously awaiting, like many other people all around the world, first battery storage prices to crash the way the solar or wind prices have crashed. Once that happens, it is my conviction that every single electron will start coming from the RE projects as well, once we take care of the intermittency issues. And the last being the lack of coordination between federal and provincial entities. Definitely, we are working on that, and we have to basically bring more harmony and synergies between the two. So this is the way we are trying to enhance our footprint on the RE side, and many other initiatives are being taken with the government. And we are also constantly apprising our Prime Minister on the development of this. And NAPRA is fully behind this. Wherever I go, whichever seminar I attend, I said, I have come from the private sector, and this is my goal to modernize this industry as much as possible. So whatever the most modern initiatives are, including inclusion of RE projects, that is definitely my forte, and I will do my very best to achieve this target. So with this, I close my talk, and I'm available for any questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was a very comprehensive overview of how you see the market, and also encouraging the how you look at the renewable energy side of this. And of course, we're still happy to hear those ambitious targets that the government of Pakistan has come up with. Now I see that there's one hand raised, Mr. Naeem Qureshi. Would you like to speak? Please, try to be brief, and you can speak now. Mr. Qureshi, Naeem Qureshi? I see there's the hand is raised, but well, Mr. Qureshi, I see your hand. There's another, or that was one more. Okay, then we try first Adil Khan.
Yeah.
Would you like to ask a question?
Yes, I want to ask that since there is no manufacturing industry in Pakistan, like when we are talking about wind, then there is no blade manufacturing, no nacelle manufacturing, nothing in Pakistan, but still we are trying to compare our tariff with the European countries. So is it really practical that without having those infrastructure in Pakistan or the facilities, will it really hopeful to meet the tariff targets, and investors will be interested to meet with this tariff?
Is this question for me?
Yes.
Yeah, it's a very interesting question, actually. One thing I did when I started exploring the possibilities of adding RE, I met few of our very renowned industrialists, and also power company CEOs, and I gave them this tip that there's a huge potential coming around at least 10,000 megawatts on the wind side, if not more, and around 10,000 megawatts on solar, if not more. So why don't you guys, you know, come up with some local manufacturing? Because that is going to definitely give a lot of comparative advantage to you. Plus, that is going to substantially reduce the rates, because the biggest chunk in this the equipment is blades and all that. So, without revealing the definitely company's name, and my discussion is still at very advanced stage, and they are working on it. But the only thing is, they are asking for a guarantee that we are going to give them a guaranteed business for at least 1 or 2 thousand megawatts of, you know, at least. But I told them the legislators have already gone ahead with the comparative bidding. And in the presence of comparative bidding, the whole idea of is comparative bidding is to bring the rates down. How can we give you an exclusive contract? So this is a chicken and egg problem. If you have a local manufacturing, naturally, whosoever you're going to support, they will might have a much better chance to win the bid. But they are saying nobody is willing to accept these terms, because what if somebody brings a comparatively cheaper resource, you know, source from, let's say, China or from somewhere else? So in few cases, somebody also brought this case to me that this doesn't sound to be a sound business case to try to develop this in Pakistan, the technology which is already being developed in some factories which are already, you know, have, let's say, a lot of capacity available. So anyhow, again, this is not our call. We are going to go for the best rates and tariff, and that is only going to be revealed after this comparative bidding. But point taken, if we have these facilities locally, naturally, there's a better chance of reducing the tariff.
Mr. Farooqi, if I may just a little bit related to that, because we've seen in some countries where there was a switch that you're now about to do from feed-in tariff to auctions, be it in India or be it in Germany, that not necessarily the prices went down, and where you have, like in Pakistan, a quite now well-developed structure of small, medium-sized companies who are investing with these 50 megawatt projects. Have you any kind of provisions that these players can still also invest with the new system? Because they were struggling. When you look at India, there were dozens of investors, and now you have two only at the end. No,
we have not put any inhibitions, any, you know, not stopping anybody from investing. But in the first phase, as you might know, that all these 103 projects that I talked about, they have already got the LOIs from the respective provincial governments. So in the first go, we are giving a chance to these guys to participate in the bidding process, you know, with a bigger chunk of auctions. But once this will be done, then going forwards, you know, this is going to be probably 2 or 3 thousand megawatts. Once this is done, all the rest of the bidding process will be done totally open. So, you know, survival of the fittest thing will be there. Whosoever is going to be the best, most comparative, bringing the best technology at the most affordable prices, we absolutely don't have any choice, or we don't have any blockade for any particular investor. Everybody is most welcome.
Well, I see here there are two more hands raised. Let's try again, Mr. Naeem Qureshi. But Mr. Farooqi, you please let us know if you run out of time. No? So that
we... I still have about 10 minutes.
Okay, fine. Let's make use of this opportunity then. Mr. Naeem Qureshi, do you want to say something? Is your hand is still raised? No, I think that seems to be a misunderstanding. So there is one Soheb Mansha.
Hello, good day everyone, and good evening, Peter. Well, I have a question related to the fair share of coal in the pie chart that I saw, like 17%. As I see, the Pakistan has a vision of having clean and green Pakistan, and we are targeting for 2030 to have renewable energy share around 26%. So my question is, then why we are still putting coal as a 17% as a fair share in that target? Because in terms of climate change or carbon neutrality, it can hinder the goal of Pakistan being a carbon neutral country in the coming decades?
Yeah, very interesting question, Zuhaib. Let me assure you one thing, that in overall words, manufacturing, Pakistan has 3% contribution, and our emissions is only 0.5%. So we are doing much, much better as far as emissions is concerned. And 17% close, compared to many advanced countries in the world is nothing. To be very honest, there are some very advanced countries who have been using coal compared to Pakistan, much, much more figures, like 50-60%. So 17% is something which I believe we can comfortably live with, because we have to mind one more thing, that we have the biggest sources of coal available in Sindh. And we also need to somehow give patronage to our local indigenous coal industry. So unless and until they will have some customers available, we will not be able to do the mining. So it's a cautious decision on part of government to go by patronizing or supporting the local coal industry. Because right now we have some plants on the imported coal, but eventually we are going to phase out all those plants and switch them over to indigenous coal. So this is again not NAPRA's decision, but government's decision. I fully support it, because 17% is something I believe which is a very reasonable target. Because again, in a bouquet of flowers, there are different types of flowers, making it beautiful. So coal is something which we have the huge, huge resources. We should capitalize on that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Farooqi. And let me just say, of course, I mean, from coming from an industrialized country, I shouldn't be the one who says Pakistan should be the first. But we see an interesting dynamic development now after China declared the climate neutrality target, which is, of course, late. But usually China does these things faster than when they announce. You have countries like Japan, South Korea following. Even Russia now declared that target. And of course, like my country, Germany, the coal phase out has been decided. I'm sure we will see even more technology development, which will make this this transition easier for everyone. And I think the core of it is what we discussed before, how fast and how affordable can the transition to renewables be for all countries, so that all the countries also have the benefits. And I think manufacturing, as you rightly mentioned, is an important part of that. I don't see any other questions. So I sincerely do say thank you to you and appreciate the time that you spent here with us. Again, it's already now on YouTube in the live stream, but I think everybody who has an interest can later also watch your presentation, like all the other speakers. So thank you again to, you're based in Islamabad, right?
Yep.
So greetings to Islamabad. A year ago, we were there. Now, unfortunately, we cannot be there, but we hope that somewhere next year, maybe there's another opportunity.
As we say, inshallah. And thank you very much, Stephen and Peter and everybody who gave me a patient hearing. And I'm always available whenever you guys need me. I'm just a phone call away. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.